social context or artistic or historically. And let me now tell you some more about our audience a little bit, because that has to do with the FoamLab initiative. This is a short overview of our audience, and we have quite a lot of international interest, but what's really important is the fact that we have a significantly younger audience than the average museum in the Netherlands. And that's also one of the main reasons to start FoamLab. But it's also something that's vastly growing because of our in-house traineeship. We try to make sure by working with young people within the organization that we keep our programming fresh and forward, and we attract new young audiences. So this is our current FoamLab. It's our seventh edition, and it started in the end of 2015. We're now working with them in their last month of their traineeship. We're right in the middle of it. It's a team of young thinkers and creators, innovative thinkers. They're selected on that. They're all recently graduated, and they have very multidisciplinary backgrounds. They're working together on projects, and they're invited to renew the museum from within. They are in-house at FOAM for 2 days a week, 8 months long, and they are working on different assignments which are designed by us and monitored and coached by mentors from the FOAM staff. And usually we form a team of eight. We also started last year with eight young people, but there are six left right now. I can tell you some more about that later. We started in 2008. This is our seventh group, and it consists of a filmmaker and a fashion designer, a graphic designer, a photographer who made this beautiful picture, an industrial designer, and a food designer. So they're really diverse in their backgrounds. So let me tell you a little bit about the program we created this year. One thing that's really, really important is the introduction. It's really important to have a proper one. Right now we have a 6 weeks introduction, which is highly needed. Because we select the members from various backgrounds, so they complement each other, and because of their own very diverse qualities, it's really important to create a group feeling. And they often lack experience in working as a group, especially working as a group as differentiated as this one. So you have to build the group from the ground up, and you also have to make sure to invest a lot of time to get to know each other, but also the museum from the inside out. So hence the introduction. And something else that has to do with that is the project coordinator. I really like the pointy thing. The project coordinator is someone who is looking out for them, someone in charge of the program, building the group, guiding them through the process, also the mediator between the FOAM staff and the trainees. And she was supposed to be here right now as well, because it's her project, and she unfortunately couldn't come. But what's also really nice to mention that she's a formal FoamLab trainee herself. So that's also something I will tell you more about later. Apart from these two aspects, like the introduction and the project coordinator, it's really all about inspiring them the first week, but also like 8 months. You have to keep them inspired through master classes, making sure they're doing a lot of research. Brainstorming is important. And also mentoring them through concept development, but also planning, organizing, funding, and making them feel truly part of your organization, which can be also quite a challenge, if I'm honest, because we have only 30 people working at the back office, and every year we had eight new trainees in the museum. So you can imagine that's quite intense also for the staff. Last but not least, the assignments, the designing of the assignments is really, really important. You have to think of good assignments, and I will tell you a lot more about that. So these were some examples of our assignments this year. On the upper left side, you can see a photo of Museum Night, which is a big event in Amsterdam. I think it's a regular concept in which museums open up their doors. And FOAM, because it's a museum with a young audience, we have a tradition of being really, really popular during Museum Night. It's a big venue, especially for young people to come. And I wanted to show a short clip, if that's possible, of the Museum Night. I can talk a little bit through. Over 5,000 people visit Museum Night at FOAM. So long queues, and it's really a challenge because we have a kind of a difficult routing in the museum. And it's really important to make sure that everyone has a good experience. That's IYY. FOAMLab was in charge of the production and organization of this night, as well as some creative concepts within the museum. You could see the guy dancing. He was a Beyoncé impersonator, and he danced for 6 hours straight. It was really, really interesting. People were quite shocked because here you can clearly see he has like something on, but real life it was kind of like he was naked and in the plastic shell. We really liked it. It was an idea of FOAMLab, and that's something that it was really it was he's like a not so well known yet, so it was a really nice concept. It was a very successful first assignment because they worked on something with a lot of responsibilities in a creative but also productive way, and they had a lot of exposure, which is also really important to keep them focused. And they had a lot of time pressure because they started working at FOAM, and they had to put it together, I think, within 4 or 5 weeks, the whole night. It was also important because this assignment was something that they worked on from the beginning as a whole group, from the start, and we make sure that we have at least 2 assignments each year in which they are working as a whole group, and 4 smaller assignments on which they are working with smaller groups. And in every assignment, the trainee has a different role, so we try to mix it up a little bit. Sometimes they get to choose their role because they're good at it, but we also try to give them something out of their comfort zone, which is really important, I think. And most of the time, that's the financial part, like the getting the funding. You could also see in the video that Jameson was quite present. That's because it's a commercial partner, and we always try and stimulate our FoamLab crew to find new partnerships. Another assignment was the one on the right. Could you click for me as well? Oh, no, sorry, yeah. This is the Instagram of FoamLab. It was interesting because Masha just told us that they were going for a hashtag for the MedKids. FoamLab has their own Instagram. Yeah, you can go down a bit. Yeah, so this is nice. And we chose for their own Instagram account because it makes it a lot easier for them to communicate what they're doing and how they're doing, and also because they have their own take on social media, and because otherwise they have to contemplate with our communication department all the time, which can be quite intense for the department. Obviously they get like a social media training before they start, but at the same time they have a lot of experience and they're doing it in their own way. Another assignment, which was one of the beginning assignment, was the redesigning of one of the workspaces in Foam. Also because we have a lot of designers in-house, so maybe you can click like one of the, it doesn't really matter which one. So this is Femke introducing a new workspace, and maybe you can click on some other. This is Stefan. And they created these small gifts to show it to the world, but also to show it to the Foam staff. And it was an interesting assignment because and inspiring, because they had to do research, and they had to focus on the needs of the Foam staff and immediately getting to know them better. And everyone's really happy with the new workspace right now. Everyone's wanting to work there. But it's their space as well for 2 days a week. So they were in charge of designing their own space. Okay, maybe go back to the presentation. And I'll talk further. Two other assignments they're working on right now. Yeah, are more in-depth. One is an assignment designed by the educational department, Foam Studios, and also the redesigning of our family tour. And the other one is the design of a platform for our curators, which is called Foam Beta. And it's a platform for their peers to meet other graduates from other backgrounds. So that's what they're working on right now. And it's interesting because the question for the family tour, I was really expecting them to work on something digital, but they made it totally tactile, and they're testing it right now. It's this one, and it's going to be really interesting, I think. And it's independent of our exhibitions, because we have so many different exhibitions. So yeah. What makes a good assignment? I think, first of all, it's good to mention a shift we've made from event-based assignments to assignments that have a more of a focus inside of the museum. While working on events was really something that FoamLab always did successfully, in the long run, it wasn't really durable. It doesn't last. And we wanted to make a shift to making changes and rethinking the organization from the inside out. And also something that will last inside of the museum. This example is Foam Editions. We have an in-house gallery, and they were in charge. That was the FoamLab last year. They were in charge of redesigning the space, but also making sure that there was enough communication inside of the building to attract a new audience. And yeah, I think it's still in-house, and it's really beautiful, and we're using it every day, and they're really proud of it, and it had a lot of exposure. So those are, I think, sustainable, exposure, creative are keywords for a good assignment. And an example of a bad assignment would be something that's too top-down. We asked them to make a video, an overview video of 2005, 15. And we thought it would be nice for them to get to know the museum better by doing interviews with the staff and editing the story. And it was presented at our annual fund meeting, so we thought, okay, exposure. But it was too top down, and also because we asked the filmmaker, it wasn't like a real challenge for them, and they felt they were only executing something. So that's an example of a bad assignment. So these are all of our former foam labs, and we started in 2008. We felt we needed, we felt there was a need for young professionals to get work experience. Graduates usually lack the experience to start working at a cultural institution, and we wanted to bridge the gap between their theoretical education and practice. And we tried to combine creativity with entrepreneurship as much as possible. And I will tell you some more about it later. At the same time, we had a need to renew our staff, or not renewed, but we need these young people as part of our staff to create events for their peers, but also to renew from the inside out. And we wanted to reach a new audience, a younger audience as well, from 18 to 35 years old, something that really works out. So I think that's one of the main reasons we started Foam Lab. And it's in the DNA of Foam to care about talent development. We have our Foam talent issue. We have the 3H space, which was the space where the guy in the suit, the Beyoncé impersonator, was dancing. That's a free space for young artists to show their work and to, make their first step into the art world. It's for us, it's really important to scout young talents at an early age, and not only on a photography level. So some best practices, I think I'll go through this really fast. Sometimes you don't really, you don't get the outcome that you expect. So for instance, we asked Foam Lab in 2011, that was when we were celebrating our 10th year of programming, and we asked, the whole museum was, there was one exhibition and it was called What's Next, and it was about our future, and they came up with an installation, also in the 3H space, not focused on photography, but focused on branding. And they thought of Foam as a brand and something that you could sell, something really commercial. And it was really hard for our director to digest. But the curator who was in charge of the Foam Lab trainees really took a stance for them. And it got really good reviews as well. So sometimes they come up with things and it's quite a risk. But if you're willing to take it, it's really out there and outgoing. So I think I have to hurry up a bit, right? Or not? Yeah, okay. So I'll skip some. Foam Lab Play was also really nice because that was a night where everything was possible in a museum, and they thought of paintballing at the museum, which was also quite intense, but really nice, and also something that we would never have thought of ourselves. So what's the value of Foam Lab for the trainees themselves? What's in it for them? I think it's very diverse. One of the biggest assets is obviously to get work experience within a museum, but also working on your portfolio and network. The group assignments is really important for them. They really learn how to work together as a team, and they discover their own unexpected talents and seeing their own unique selling points. And we, as I said before, we really try and give them like an insight in how to be a cultural entrepreneur, and we never just give them a budget to produce something. They really have to convince us of their plans and sell us their plans and find financing as well. So they get targets. They have to like make sure that there's funding of 20,000 euros a year. They have to make sure that they have at least 2,000 participants. So we set the standard really high. And it's really hard for them, but they're always really grateful in the end. And the value for the museum, what's in it for us, it's a number of reasons as well. It gives us the opportunity to scout young talent at a very, very early stage, not only photographers, but curators. We have a couple of ex-Foam Lab trainees working at the museum right now. One is assistant to the curator, one is the project coordinator of Foam Lab, and another one is working at my department. But at the same time, they're working in other places, at radio stations, important like newspapers, and they're part of our network as well from a very early start, so that's good. And also the renewing of your audience, being on top of new trends and media, content-wise, new fresh ideas, and being really critical towards your own organization. So yeah, there are the ambassadors of the project, but also Foam themselves. So the shift from events to innovation, I think I already pointed that out. I think it's not. It was something that we really wanted to change, but it was also because of the changing of the cultural climate in Amsterdam. Because there are more and more initiatives like this, which is really good. But we wanted to take it a step further and to really incorporate the ideas within the organization. And at the same time, I think that's also better for the trainees, because they're taking more seriously and working on diverse assignments, and there's more attention for their personal experience. Yeah. Okay. You're... Oh, okay. I'm sorry. So the challenges of Foam Lab for us are there are many. I have to be honest. Funding, for instance, we've heard it a lot the last 2 days, but that's quite a challenge because it's an ongoing project. So we have to find funding every year again, and because we're already at our 7th edition, it gets harder and harder, and we really do not want the trainees to pay for their traineeship as well. We want to pay them. So since 2014 we started paying them, which is important because it makes the group more diverse. People from various social economic backgrounds can compete, otherwise it wouldn't be possible, and it makes them more responsible. They really think of it as a job instead of something they do voluntarily. So, and there's no exclusion, and I think that's really important as well. Another challenge is how to keep the balance between the freedom and creativity of the Foam Lab and the level of quality for the museum. We're stimulating exposure and also collaborating with the commercial partners, professional partners, and for the outside world, Foam Lab is Foam, so that's kind of a risk in itself, and we really have to trust them to do it by themselves, and so that's also that can be quite a challenge. You really have to coach them through it. They are usually they're quite young, and they're usually unexperienced, and they have high expectations and kind of big egos as well. So we really have to manage that, all of that. So it's important also for them as a group and for us to keep them in house. And that's a challenge because of two reasons. One of them, because they're really high profile and they get scouted by other institutes for a real job offer, something that sometimes they cannot refuse. And of course, we understand that as well. And at the same time, there are so many moments during the traineeship, because it's 8 months, and that are hard for them, and they're not motivated. Usually, when they're working on an assignment, the first stage is interesting because it's concept development, and the last stage is interesting because they have the exposure. And everything in between, like the largest part, it's a pain in the ass for them. They don't like planning, they don't like organizing, they don't like get the funding, and they're whining, and they're really young, and we tend to forget it all the time because they're also really good at what they're doing. So we really have to keep them in house, and it's really hard to get them motivated. And sometimes, yeah, we have the dropouts, and sometimes it's because they're not motivated anymore, and they think it's too hard for them. And so then we try to stimulate them to work towards the end, because that's when like the fun really starts. But at the same time, yeah, because of the high profiles, they get job offers at other organizations, like real jobs. So sometimes we lose them like that. And it's also hard to keep the staff motivated sometimes, because I'm really enthusiastic, but not all departments share the same interest. So to conclude, if you are interested in starting your own traineeship, which I would totally recommend, but please consider the next questions, and time investment is one of the first things that I would consider. Do you really want to invest all that time and money? And secondly, what are your goals with the traineeship? You have to make it specific. What will be the assignment, and will there be an assignment at all? What are the possibilities within the museum? What can you offer the trainees? And last of all, who will be part of your traineeship, of your lab? What kind of profile are you looking for? So I think that's my story. Thank you.